family, welcome again to another online Sunday. I hope the Lord will bless you and He will place in your heart what you have to do with this message. And I pray that we will worship together and that the Lord will bless you also with your health and everything you do.
Amen. Here we are, what, on week seven? Six, seven?
I think it's six or seven.
I lose track. But we're glad that you're still tuning in and watching us as we worship. Here we are in the youth room again this week. We're going to be moving around the church a little bit so everybody can see their area.
That's right.
Do some in the children's area and some different things. Maybe even the bathroom 1 week. We're not really sure. We're still working on that one. We like the acoustics there.
That's right.
We can't get everybody in there for
it's
sure.
Very but acoustic.
Exactly. Right? But we're glad that you're here. We want to worship today. But we want to start off with Bible reading as always.
All right. So we're going to read Psalms 61, and it says, "Hear my cry, O God. Listen to my prayer. From the ends of the earth I call to you. I call as my heart grows faint. Lead me to the rock that is higher than I, for you have been my refuge, a strong tower against the foe.
I long to dwell in the tent forever and take refuge in the shelter of your wings. For you, God, have heard my vows. You have given me the heritage of those who fear your name."
The next verse says, "Increase the days of the king's life, his years for many generations. May he be enthroned in God's presence forever. Appoint your love and faithfulness to protect him."
"Then I will ever sing in praise of your name and fulfill my vows day after day."
Amen. Well, Amen. We see how great of a friend and Lord is Jesus. Amen. So how about if we pray and then we sing? Let's do that. Let's bow our heads. Father, thank you so much for this time. Bless, Lord, every mother, father, child that is at home right now. I pray, Lord, that you will speak to their hearts and you will, Lord, help us to bless your name together in this time. I pray this in the name of Jesus, our Lord and our Savior. And everybody say,
Amen.
Amen. Let's go and sing What a Friend, this song from Maher. Let's sing it together.
Heartbreak, isolation, ooh, ooh, ooh.
Yes, His heart is our home. And you know what? One day we will be with Him forever and ever. Amen. And that is the hope of the believers. The next song that we're going to sing is the beautiful hymn, Great is Thy Faithfulness. Danny, would you read the Bible reference that this song came from?
It's from Lamentations 3, 22 through 24. It says, "The steadfast love of the Lord never ceases. His mercies never come to an end. It says, they are new Amen. Every morning. Great is your faithfulness.
Yes.
The Lord is my portion, says my soul. Therefore, I will hope in Him."
Amen. Let's go and sing this beautiful song that says, "Great is Thy faithfulness." Let's sing it together.
Oh God, my
See and recognize your faithfulness in our lives, Lord, because you have been so gracious and so merciful and so good, Lord. Your mercies are new every morning, Lord. I pray that you will give us, Lord, creativity, that you will give us, Lord, the opportunities to bless others as we live our Christian life, Lord. Now I pray in the name of Jesus that you will bless, Lord, our pastor and the message that he will bring. And Lord, thank you for his life. And I pray that you will speak to us, Lord. In the name of Jesus, I pray. Amen. Pastor Darren.
All right. Thank you, worship team, for leading us today in our music. And before we pray and open up God's word, I want to just remind you, this is the second week that we are up in the youth room. Now, this is the old sanctuary. And so from the 1950s until the new worship center was built several years ago. This was the place. As a matter of fact, some of you that are watching me now, you were baptized in the old church baptistry that is no longer on that wall. But if you go back to this storage area and climb up, you can still see the mural from the old baptistry on the wall. Some of you that are watching today stood very close to this spot, and you exchange vows before an assembly that were gathered together and in the presence of God, and you were married. And so this room has a lot of memories for a lot of Anaheites people. But before we look into God's word today, let's just thank God for the history of Anaheites Baptist Church and the people that may have walked this aisle at one point and confessed Christ and as Lord and Savior, and what God is going to do in the future. Just this week, we have heard from our governor that the stay-at-home orders have been extended through the end of May. And so let's just pray for the grace of God and the mercy of God, and God's will be done as we continue to do ministry in Anaheim. So let's pray. Father, we come to you today. I want to thank you for my church family, and I pray that you would give them patience and perseverance during this time. I pray, Father, that you would give them hope, because their hope is based in you and not the circumstances that are around them. Father, we thank you for the history of this church that's represented in this very room. Lord, the lives that were changed by the grace of God through faith here, the marriages that were begun as a couple were pronounced man and wife, and Lord, just the many good times that were shared here. And as we open up your word today, I pray that your Holy Spirit would be right here with us, teaching us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. So you'll want to have 1 Peter chapter 2 handy, because that's where we're continuing today. Before we read our scripture passage, I want to tell you a quick story about a Disney movie that many of you, probably most of you, are familiar with. It's the original Toy Story movie. And so this movie is about a group of toys that are owned by a boy named Andy. And one toy in particular, his name is Woody. And the thing that's peculiar about Woody, this cowboy with a hat and a six-shooter and the whole works, is this, is that he was Andy's favorite toy. And because he was Andy's favorite toy, he had a special status even among the other toys. And everything was going great until one day, one birthday party. And at that birthday party, Andy got a Buzz Lightyear toy. And immediately, Buzz became Andy's new favorite toy, or at least he was as popular as Woody was. But the interesting thing about this this story is the toys themselves. These toys found their value and their purpose in relationship to Andy. As a matter of fact, you could lift up Woody's foot or Buzz Lightyear's foot, and you know what you'd find inscribed on the bottom of their shoe? Andy's name. And it was telling everyone that these toys were Andy's possession. Well, today in 1 Peter, we have a very familiar scenario. We find that the apostle tells us this, that we as believers in Jesus Christ, that we are God's special possession, that we are His chosen people. And so let's look at 1 Peter chapter 2, beginning with verse 9 through verse 12, as we look at your holiness for God's glory. So let's begin reading with verse 9. But you are a chosen race, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a people for His own possession, that you may proclaim the excellencies of Him who called you out of darkness into His marvelous light. Once you were not a people, but now you are God's people. Once you had not received mercy, but now you have received mercy. Verse 11, Beloved, I urge you as sojourners and exiles to abstain from the passions of the flesh, which wage war against your soul. Keep your conduct among the Gentiles honorable, so that they speak against you as evildoers. They may see your good deeds and glorify God on the day of visitation. Well, as we look at this passage today in just these few verses, there are two points that we want to examine. And the first one is this, is believers belong to God. And that is brought out strongly in those first two verses. And the second point is this today, is that holiness in this life matters in eternity. So the first thing today is believers belong to God. And so I want you to notice as we begin this passage in verse 9 that we have God's choice is spelled out for us clearly. Listen to the words that he says. He says, you are a chosen race, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a people for His own possession. Most of these phrases are phrases that are steeped in Old Testament scripture passages. And it's talking about God's people, the Jewish nation. But when the Apostle Peter talks about this group in 1 Peter, he's not talking about the Jews. He's not talking about Israel. He's talking about the church, God's chosen people. So listen to these strong words of ownership. He says, you are a chosen race. The Lord says, you did not choose me, I chose you. He also calls us who believe in Christ Jesus a royal priesthood. Well, in the Old Testament, what did the priests do? Well, the priests were the ones who stood between God and man. But one of the most precious things that they did is they had direct contact with God. And listen, as followers of Jesus Christ, as a royal priesthood, that means that we have face-to-face fellowship with the Lord. So a chosen race, a royal priesthood, a holy nation. What does it mean to be a holy nation? Well, Israel was a nation that was set apart, and that's what holy means. And as the church, we are set apart for God. We are uniquely His like no other people. And then he says, in summary, a people for His own possession. We are God's by His choice. I also want you to notice, beginning at the end of verse 9, not only God's choice, but also God's action. And as you read these next few phrases, notice that the Lord talks about what we didn't have, but now we do have. So at the end of verse 9, this is what he says in God's action. He says, who called you out of darkness into His marvelous light. So we were in darkness, and now when we believe in Christ, we're in light. Then he says, once you were not a people, we didn't know God, but now we are God's people. And then he says, once you did not have mercy, but now you have received mercy. So where we were, but after God's action of salvation, where we are. We are now a people that, instead of being in the darkness, we are in light. Instead of being a people that are estranged, we are considered God's people. And a people that were under judgment, now we are under mercy of God. So notice, you have God's choice, His chosen people, and then you have God's action. But what do you have in the middle? Right in the middle of these two verses, this is what we find. It's our response. It says that you, the believers, the chosen race, those who receive mercy, that you may proclaim the excellencies of Him. We will praise God. But this is more than our response. This is the reason. This is the reason why we are a chosen race. This is the reason why God showed us mercy. This is the reason why we are His special possession and a holy nation, so that we will proclaim His excellencies. So we will make much of God. So let's stop for a moment, because I believe as followers of Christ that we need to reorient our thinking sometimes. You see, there are many teachers out there that try to tell us that this salvation is all about us. It's all about what God will do in our life. They pitch us this idea that the salvation is about God making us happy. It's about our individual fulfillment. And the appointed end of salvation is all about us. And you know what, folks? That's just not right. Listen to this quote that I read from one of these teachers just today. It says, God wants us to prosper financially, to have plenty of money, to fulfill the destiny He has laid out for us. This is wrong on so many levels. What it does is it takes this salvation and it makes us the center of the universe in salvation. And that's not what the Bible teaches us at all. This passage has told us what God has done for us. Man, God has blessed us. He has made us a chosen people. He has made us a people that did not know Him, but now we do. He has given us mercy. He has done all of these things, rescued us from darkness and given us light and put us into His kingdom. But the reason that God did all of these blessings was primarily for His glory, the Bible says. You see, we belong to Him. And the greatest good that we can ever do is to praise the name of our Lord God and to make much of Him. See, when God is the thing that we treasure most in this life, then we are the most satisfied. When God is the thing that's most precious to us in these days, then our joy is more full than it could ever be. Why? Because He is the one who satisfies us. He is our satisfaction. So notice in this passage, as we look at our holiness for God's glory, that we are His, and He has saved us so that we can serve Him and make much out of Him. So the second thing that we want to see is in these last two verses, verses 11 and 12. And I want to read those one more time just to remind you what they say. Beloved, I urge you as sojourners and exiles to abstain from the passions of the flesh, which wage war against your soul. Keep your conduct among the Gentiles honorable, so that when they speak against you as evildoers, they may see your good deeds and glorify God on the day of visitation. Well, you know, according to these verses, the life that you live now, the life that God has given you, it is a battle. Wouldn't it be great if once we came to faith in Christ, we no longer struggled with desire to do sin, that we no longer struggled with evil? But the fact is, verse 11 says, it is a war, that the passions of this flesh wage war against our very souls. If God wants us to live a holy life, and that's what He's telling us in this passage, then half of living a holy life is this battle with sin that we take on every day of our life. You notice in this passage, Peter and the Lord calls these Christians sojourners and exiles. Why is He calling them aliens? What, did they climb over the fence and sneak into the country? Why is He saying this? Well, no. Remember, who do these Christians belong to? Well, they belong to the Lord, don't they? They're His people. They're His chosen race. They're His special possession. He has made them a holy nation, right? So they belong to the kingdom of God. And if we want to win the spiritual battle that we are fighting every day, it begins with a mindset of this, is that I belong to the Lord. And I live right here in the middle of this earth and all of its struggles, but I am a pilgrim. I am passing through this world, and I belong to God. I am one of His children. And because of that mentality, then I can fight against the evil passions that still hang around me, but Jesus has already defeated. You know, I believe that God keeps us saved, that God not only saves us, He keeps us saved, that He has a strong hand and no one can break His grip. When it comes to battle against sin, my friends, do not underestimate the power of your will. That we are called to fight against sin with every fiber in our being, that we are to resist it as much as we can, and we have the Holy Spirit of God that indwells us to empower us for success. We are not passive instruments in this battle that we let go and we let God. We bend our will to the will of God, and we fight this battle with the weapons that God has given us. Listen, sin is waging war against your soul. And if you want to be a holy person and one that follows Christ devotedly, then you must fight this battle with sin. You and I both. Now, I notice in verse 12, you see the results of this sin. It says, keep your conduct among the Gentiles honorable, so that when they speak against you as evildoers, they may see your good deeds and glorify God on the day of visitation. So allow me to set up what's going on here in 1 Peter with this church that he is writing to, because it helps us to interpret and apply these truths to our life. So Peter is writing to a group of believers that they are living in this Roman culture, and the gods that they worship were the Greek and Roman gods of the pantheon. And these believers once worshiped those gods. And worship of these gods involved going to the temple and offering sacrifices. There were festivals and feasts and celebration, and all of their friends and all of their neighbors would go to these feasts, and they would have a big party. And many times there were orgies, there were temple prostitutes involved, and all kinds of drunkenness and immorality took place during these festivals. And once these Christians believed in Christ, they no longer did these things. And their neighbors and their friends looked around at them and said, what's going on here? These people, they don't even believe in our gods. They are atheists. They don't believe in gods anymore. Not only that, but they are unpatriotic. They're not Romans. They don't bow to Caesar as Lord. And so they saw these Christians as evildoers. And so this is what Peter says. They will speak against you as evildoers. But you know what they're going to see? They're going to see your holy life. They're going to see your good deeds. Friends, in the world that we live in right now, you know who you belong to, don't you? You belong to the Lord. You are His special possession. You were made for Him. And we do not get involved in the standard and the lifestyle of this world. We are called to live godly and holy lives. And people could make fun of us. People may not even be around us sometimes because they feel guilty. But let me tell you what your holy life is going to do. Your holy life will set an example and will open up doors of witness to your neighbors. Why? Because they will see that you are different, and many of them will want what you have. So notice the end of this passage. It's so that when they speak against you as evildoers, they may see your good deeds and glorify God on the day of visitation. So let me ask you this question. Does the life that you live right now, does it affect the future? And you say, well, of course it does. You know, the last church I pastored, even before my time there, there was, the church had a closed closet ministry is what they called it. And they had a separate building away from the main campus of the church. And they had a very large room, almost as big as a small store. And it was chock full of clothing that people would donate. And so someone could come in, and they had certain hours it was open, and you could come in and you could get free clothing. And it was a very active ministry. Well, you know, a person decided, you know, we should have a Bible study on this day of the week. We should have it right there in the clothes closet. So someone began a Bible study where there was a lady that was coming, and she began attending the Bible study. And at some point in that Bible study, this woman confessed Christ. And isn't that great? I mean, that was the whole point, wasn't it? And she began coming to the church, and she had a young adult daughter that had a little girl. And she was having some difficult times in her life. And she began to invite her daughter to church with her. And so her daughter began to come. And guess what happened? the Lord saved her and changed her life. And by the time she had another daughter, and both of her daughters were raised in church. Let me ask you a question. Does your life now, does your holy life now, does it make an impact into eternity? It absolutely does. This is one little story that covers just a few years of time. Let me tell you, but your holy life will reach into eternity because there are people that will glorify God when Jesus comes back and they stand before Him and they will confess Him as Lord because of your holy life. Now, I can't imagine too many other reasons better than that to live a godly life now. See, many times we think our battle with sin and living a godly life is all about just getting rid of these sinful habits and these destructive things in our life, then it will benefit us. But let me tell you, your holy life will impact others more than it even impacts your own life. You know, the opposite is still true. There are some of us today that there are sins that we have committed or maybe are committing that are hampering our witness. You confess Christ Jesus, but there are people that you may work with or live around you that see your immorality and they say, why would I want to go to a church like that? Or why would I want to believe in the God that this person confesses? So let me tell you, your life now impacts eternity. You know, as we come to a close today, Andy's Toys, you know, Buzz and Woody, great little story. You know, you lift up their bodies and look in the bottom of their foot, and there it says Andy right on the bottom. Let me tell you, your salvation in Christ Jesus and God's ownership of you is so much more precious. And today, I want you to leave understanding this, that you, as a follower of Christ, belong to the Lord. And the most valuable thing in this life that you have going for you is not your bank account, it's not your health, it's not even your family. Let me tell you, I love my family. The most valuable thing that you have going for you is that you belong to the Lord and you were made for His glory. And part of that glory is the life that you live now, a life that you were called to be holy, to be godly. Half of that godly life is destroying the sin that still hampers you in this life. So do battle with it. And God's Spirit is in you to give you success. Before we turn the service back over to our worship team and Pastor JC, I want to pray for you today. Because I know that there are some of you that are struggling with sin right now. And even as I said these words, there's a burden in your soul. Why is there a burden in your soul? Because that's where the war is waged the deepest. And listen, I want to encourage you followers of Christ in who you are, that you know who you are, whose you are, and why you are living this life. Do not give up your godly life. It is worth it. So let's pray together today as we close. Father, we come to you. I thank you for my brothers and sisters in Christ today, and I have spoken squarely to them from your word. God, I thank you for this truth that we have seen today, that we are your people. We are a holy nation that has been set apart for you. And God, that is the most precious treasure that we have, is that we belong to you. So help us to live our lives for you, to live godly lives, that we can break the power of sin because Christ has already defeated it on the cross and through His resurrection. And that, Lord, our godly life now, Lord, makes impact into eternity. And Father, because of the life that we live, that someone will be drawn to Christ, just like it says in Matthew chapter 5, let your light so shine before men that they may see your good works and glorify your Father who is in heaven. Peter was there that day when the Lord Jesus spoke those words. And Lord, the lesson rang true in his life, and I pray it will in everyone's life that hears my words today. Lord, we thank you so much. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Thank you, church family, for being with us today. And now Pastor JC will lead us in a closing song. God bless you.
Thank you, Pastor Darrell. Let's just pray real fast. Lord, we thank you for this message. And Lord, I pray that as we learn these truths, Lord, that you would just move in our hearts in a special way. Help us to rely upon your power and just to trust in your word. We thank you. And we give this time to you now, Father, as we sing this last song. May you be moved. May your ears be pleased with what it hears. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
When the music fades, all is stripped away, and I simply come, longing just to breathe something that's good, that will bless your heart. I'll bring you more than a song, for the song is is not what you have required. You search much deeper within, through the way things appear. You're looking into my heart. I'm coming back to the heart.
last chorus, and let's tell the Lord, Lord, help us to make our lives all about you. Let's sing it together.
I'm coming back to the heart of worship, and it's all about you.
Yes, Lord.
It's all about you, Jesus. I'm sorry, Lord, for the thing I made it. When it's all about you, when it's all about you, Jesus.
Oh, Father, we thank you for your Son, Jesus. And we thank you, Lord, for the power of the Holy Spirit that saved our souls through the gospel of Jesus Christ by faith, by grace. Lord, in the name of Jesus, we ask you that you will touch the lives of the people that are watching this video, that you will, Lord, convict them, that you will move them, that you will, Lord, make them better in their lives. And Father, I pray that our lives will be all about you. That everything that we do, say, think, Lord, we will make it all about you. Father, please, in the name of Jesus, move among us, Lord. We plead with you in the name of Jesus. And we all say, amen.
Amen. Amen.
Thank you very much for being with us. Thank you very much, because it is a joy to do this. And you are at home, and I pray the Lord will bless you. Don't forget that there are three ways to give, right? And this helps to reach the lost, to teach the found, and to send the disciple. So the number one way is bring it by the office, right?
Yes. Yes.
Number two?
Number two is you can mail it in, good old snail mail, right?
And if you are techie, as our good pastor Danny, you can go to anaheights.com, click give here or something like that.
Yes, yes, right there on the first page.
And do your contribution there. You know, remember, this is to reach, teach, and send as we make disciples of Christ. That is all that the church exists for. Amen. So thank you very much for your attention. I pray the Lord will help us to stay one more time next Sunday here together. And there is more people involved than the ones that you just seen here behind the camera. Thank you, Aaron. I appreciate it. And behind the slides that we look at to play and sing as Lucas, thank you so much for that. And God bless you all. We pray that the Lord will bring you next time. Have a good day.